Greetings from the School for Democracy, from family and friends of Dr. S. Anand Lakshmi. Anand to all of you. Anand was very involved with the concept of the School for Democracy from the early years of its conception to what it is today. The organization considers it a privilege that the 50 assembled there today to welcome all of you to the stimulating evening of celebration of a life that has touched so many of us. Anand, as many of us called her, was a woman of many parts, and her friends reflect her many interests and enthusiasm. She was very dear to me as an exciting friend and part of my family with whom I could share even tentative ideas and perceptions, our mutual love for literature, music, and not in the least our concern for a tolerant and equal and just India. I miss her, as all of you do, as much for what she stood for, as her intelligence, her conversation, her wit, and her sense of humor. She did not take kindly to shortcuts or intellectual tardiness and kept even everyday conversations up to her standard of reasoned sensibility. Without testing your patience more, we will light a lamp in our minds, in your hearts and mine, to pay homage to the compassion and intelligence of an India she knew and loved, where differences were natural and exciting, and tolerance and justice was a way of life. A toast to Anand and her generation of Indians who kept the spirit of the Buddha, Gandhi and Ambedkar alive and believed that all of us are indeed equal. I would like to now introduce and invite Suma Balagopal, Anand's niece, to talk to us about her, a remembrance of her life with pictures that recall her long association with many of us. Dr. Suma Balagopal, MD, DPM, MRC, Psychology, is a psychiatrist by training and inclination. She uses her interest in writing to try and demystify science and medicine to reach out to people, which she is passionate about. Having trained and worked in the UK and in India, she is comfortable with cultural nuances and how they influence mental health. Suma is so much a part of all our lives. I invite her to share her thoughts with us. Suma.
Greetings and welcome to all of you. We are gathered here today from all over the world to remember and celebrate the life of Dr. Anand Lakshmi, known to many as Anand and to a few as Anna. Many of you will remember what it felt like to be in her orbit, to delight in her quicksilver mind, her welcoming warmth, and her uncompromising integrity. You might have been invited to share a simple home-cooked meal served in elegant dishes, coffee in a textured mug, or a sparkling conversation that spanned many worlds of interest and passion and knowledge. You would have been introduced to her eclectic collection of books and music and art, and indeed friends, from a weaver she helped to buy a loom, to a former governor, an old student, a famous musician, or a modest school teacher. It was impossible to predict who would drop in for tea, and she was equally engaged and empathetic and involved with all of them. In thinking about the vibrant tapestry of her life, it seems that there are some clear threads that run through it. The first one was giving children a voice. Shaped by her earliest experiences at the Besant School in Adyar, Anand would recall a personal experience with a visiting Mario Montessori at monsoon time, with a cool breeze blowing into the thatched classroom. "Follow me," he cried, and the nine-year-olds ran down to the beach and came back drenched and skipping with joy. Anand always remembered this as the best class she had ever attended in all her years of being a student. Years later, as principal of the Vidyamandir School in Madras with her sister in the early 60s, she tried to bring the same joy to her teaching. It was a very different school from anything at the time. Inclusivity was the norm, and children were celebrated for their diverse talents and skills, where differently abled children were integrated into the classroom, where the most disruptive and naughty children were given responsibilities that transformed them, and the most enjoyable classes were those held on the veranda and under the trees. One of her students from that time touchingly described the essence of his experience as the absence of fear. This takes us on to Anand's love for learning. She was captivated by a new idea or point of view, read voraciously till her last day, and was always happy to have a good discussion or an agreeable disagreement. Academically inclined, she and her sister Kalyan Lakshmi took university goals in their respective subjects as undergraduates and were known by everyone of that generation simply as the twins. She could have stayed on as the principal of a school till she retired, but it is this spirit of wanting to learn that took her to Bryn Mawr in America in pursuit of her master's and later her doctorate, in search of further worlds to explore in every sense. It was a perilous journey, lasting 6 weeks on a P&O liner that embarked from Bombay. But the friends she made on this voyage and during her time there remained lifelong companions. Her exposure to different ways of thinking and learning and teaching enriched all her later endeavors. Now, perhaps the one thing that comes to mind when we remember what Anand was like is her gift for communicating. Upon her return from America, she set off for the Lady Irwin College in Delhi. Rising to become its director, she spent the best years of her professional life establishing the Department of Child Development, the first of its kind in the country, whose 50th year celebrations she lived to attend. Her students from those first batches remember her as a breath of fresh air in the classroom, urging them to think critically, pushing them out of their comfort zones, and showing them the importance of a well-rounded life filled with concerts and plays and new books and good food and varied and interesting friends within the dry confines of academia. She was a role model and mentor to many, and they later not only were counted among her closest friends, but became colleagues in her department and similar departments which she helped set up all over the country. Some of them went on to careers overseas, and she faithfully kept the connections alive. In later years, when she gave up active teaching, Anand communicated through her writing. She had a remarkable felicity with words and a way of making the most abstruse subject seem personal and relevant. Her clarity of thought made her a valuable addition to the many committees and government bodies she served on, and her exhortations to optimize, not just maximize, are still being quoted. She wrote the script for a remarkable documentary on the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which brought it to vivid life. She compiled some of her articles into a book, Thinking with the Heart, which she painstakingly mailed to dozens of friends. She was the kind of person who would wince at typos in the newspaper and silently edit every article she read. She was a whiz at Scrabble, which she played with three generations of family, and she devoured the cryptic crossword every day. When she was with her siblings, clues and words flew across the room in a kind of rapid shorthand. But this also meant she was a tough critic, as her students and colleagues will attest to, asking for rewrites and changes till the words flowed just right and conveyed exactly what they were meant to. And this was because Anand was, above all, a connoisseur of the apt turn of phrase, the perfect rendition of a raga, the exact seasoning of a dish, the intricacy of a handloom fabric, or the curve of a beautiful mud pot. She had a love for the arts that pervaded every aspect of her life. Blessed with a beautiful singing voice, she acquired a deep knowledge of music. She savored both Carnatic and Hindustani music, and her time in Delhi was enlivened by concerts within walking distance of college, and in those more relaxed times, many musicians became personal friends. A visit to one of Anand's soirees was always an aesthetic feast. A winter evening in the big old red brick director's bungalow on the Lady Irwin campus, with fires in the fireplaces, convivial company of all ages talking animatedly, the clink of glasses and the swish of silk, and often a sing-song to end the evening. This was also a favorite family pastime, and the songs would be from a dozen languages in addition to the beautiful Sanskrit compositions. Anand brought the same discerning eye to art and poetry and books as she did to music, and everything on her walls or on her bookshelves had a story, usually a bit of an adventure with a serendipitous find at the end. She collected these things not because it was fashionable to do so, but because she either knew or was drawn to the artist. But in spite of her global worldview and her experiences across continents, Anand never lost sight of the ideals with which she started her journey. She came from a remarkably progressive family which broke every traditional mold and helped to shape her strong sense of social justice. An early exposure to theosophy meant that the belief in equality of all religions and faiths was fundamental. Anand's involvement with mobile creches in Delhi and later her work with so many other organizations, Seva in Ahmedabad, MKSS and Thelonia in Rajasthan, Voluntariat in Pondicherry, the Krishnamurti Foundation and Balamandir in Chennai, spoke to the other thread that ran through her life unwaveringly, a passionate commitment to social justice and equality. In all the noise and confusion of modern life, she never lost sight of what she really believed in. There was one person who had a profound effect on Anand's life, someone whom she thought of as a teacher, a warm presence, and this was the Dalai Lama. She first met him in the late 70s and over the years had several treasured encounters with him. In one such forum, His Holiness asked the question, "How do you teach compassion to children?" That simple question resonated with Anand. In all the many people whose lives she touched and the different environments in which she found herself, compassion remained one of the guiding principles of her life and work. It is now 2 years since she was last with us, and this is the second memorial concert to celebrate and remember her. We are deeply honored to have with us today Sri T.M. Krishna, who, apart from being a Carnatic musician par excellence, also had a personal connection with Anand. We value both the purity and authenticity of his music, as well as the clarity of his voice in standing up for issues of justice and freedom. And I know that Anand would have been touched and delighted to welcome him today, as are we. Let us enjoy the privilege of being invited to his concert.
We are particularly happy that T.M. Krishna is going to share his thoughts and music with us today in celebration of Anand's life. Many of us have spent rare and special times together chatting and drinking coffee. Anand and I went together to hear Krishna in a concert when he still sang in the formal season, and we exchanged telling glances throughout the concert to register our mutual delight. We all became friends in due course, but I'm sure that somewhere she's listening to him today. We often say a celebrity needs no introduction, but I feel sometimes they do. As admirers of one aspect of an individual, we often do not know the other parts. Krishna is a vocalist in the Carnatic tradition. His musicality eludes standard analyses, we all know that. Uncommon in his rendition of music and original in his interpretation of it, Krishna is at once strong and subtle, manifestly traditional and stunningly innovative. As a public intellectual, Krishna speaks and writes about issues affecting the human condition, about matters cultural. Krishna has started and is involved in many organizations whose work is spread across the whole spectrum of music and culture. He is also a writer. He has authored many award-winning books, including Voices Within Carnatic Music, Passing On an Inheritance, A Southern Music, The Carnatic Story, a first of its kind, a philosophical, aesthetic, and socio-political exposition of Carnatic music, Reshaping Art, addresses crucial issues, caste, class, and gender within society while exploring the contours of democracy, culture, and learning. His last book, Sebastian and Sons, traces the history of the mridangam maker and the mridangam over the past century. He has been part of inspiring collaborations such as the Chennai Parambok Padal with environmentalist Nityanand Jayaraman, performances with the Jogappas, transgender musicians, and co-conceptualizing and performing Carnatic Kattai Kattu, an unusual aesthetic conversation between art forms and communities that belong to two ends of the social spectrum. He has been remarkable in addressing all the contentious issues that arise from culture. He has become a voice for the underprivileged. He has been the recipient of many awards. I welcome Krishna to share his thoughts and voice with us today. We all look forward to a scintillating evening. Krishna.
Thank you very much, Aruna, and thank you, Suma. And thank you all for inviting me today. It's truly an honor to be part of this celebration of Anandalakshmi Akka. I must actually say that I first knew Kalyani Akka before I knew Anandalakshmi Akka. Because when I was a student in the school KFI, I was first introduced to her as a student. And then I came to know Anandalakshmi Akka also. And it has always been a joy to talk to her, to listen to her, and therefore to participate in a celebration of such a wonderful, special, thoughtful, and truly joyous human being is an honor and a privilege. I'm going to speak for a while and then sing. It's a little difficult to do both on the same day, but I'm going to try. Please pardon me if I fail in any one of the endeavors. Art in education can mean so many things. That's the theme I have broadly stated for today's conversation. It can refer to art in a classroom, a regular school classroom. It can refer to art as a learning process in itself, where we learn art, music classes, etc. It can also refer to the formalized ways of learning art, art universities, art colleges, pedagogy, etc. So I'm going to try and touch upon these few elements because each of them require at least a few hours of conversation. The very word art itself is complex, and everyone has a certain imagery of what it is. What can be defined as art? What is not art? That's probably more contentious. For example, is cooking an art form? Can we call it an art form? What are the characteristics of something to have that framework of being referred to as an art form? Or is it art-like? So even that very idea of something being art, before we even address the learning of it, requires a lot of thought. But for today's conversation, I am limiting this framework to art forms that are organized in various cultures across India and across the globe, whether they are visual, oral, plastic arts, dance, theater. That diversity is, of course, there, but I'm referring to this formalized ideas of art production, if you want to call that. And when we say art in education, we think of schools. And unfortunately, like every word, even the idea of school is segregated today. One very, very commonly used term that we all use is mainstream and alternative. In a way, complicated and disturbing kind of an expression. What is a mainstream school? What is an alternative school? Are we creating hierarchies when we say that? I mean, I'm just throwing out these questions, not necessarily knowing the answer. But when we say art in a mainstream school, there is a certain notion of what role art plays in that school. And that comes to my mind immediately. So art is that art class. It could be music class. It could be that painting class. It could be that. It's that one period which is plugged in the mainstream framework. And what is the mainstream framework? The mainstream framework is to create students who have scored a certain percentage of marks and who would contribute to society in what is an acceptable way of contributing to society, which is only measured by one metric, which is fundamentally economic. So we see mainstream schools, or shall we say, we judge mainstream schools in this little box. And art then is given a kind of a fixed role within those schools, and that's how we see it. Now, if a student from that happens to come out and become an artist or a singer, that is accidental to the actual system. There could be one wonderful teacher, one person who understands, but that doesn't change what we perceive or what we've constructed as a system of education, where what role art plays. I was talking to some young boy yesterday, studying in a, within quotes, mainstream school in Bangalore, and he said, in my school, there is no art. So it was a very unusual statement for an artist to listen to. What does it mean by there is no art in school? It meant that there is no celebration of painting or music. Songs are just part of regulation. It needs to be sung for identity of something that the school is creating. This is one framework. The other framework we have is alternative schools. Now, alternative schools also function, unfortunately, with a certain prism of perception of art. The idea of the alternative is not to succumb to the mainstream, that all that is prioritized by the mainstream in terms of how it is influenced by the marketplace, influenced by what is seen as good, correct education, are challenged or are embedded within the larger understanding of education in which art plays an important role. But even here, I will dare to say that art does have a limited role. It is still seen as something that enhances the entire experience of education, entire perception of learning, entire experience of the environment and people, but it is not seen as itself. Can art just exist because it exists, not because it does something, however beautiful and good and correct the observations may be? And I think sometimes in that loss, if I may call it that, art's intentionality is blurred. Its celebration for being itself disappears. So it is, even in the alternative framework, art is playing a role. It's providing something for something else. And therefore, the importance of art in that environment is what it gives to everything else that the alternative school treasures. I'm not finding fault with this idea, but I am challenging the notion that art needs to provide something for the rest. Can it just be, is the question. Even in the notion of art, there are certain categories that come in, and it's important that we observe these categories. I'm not saying all schools practice them, but they sometimes just happen very naturally. There is a very important difference between what is treated as formal and what is treated as informal. So within the school framework, I think it is sometimes fascinating to observe, also disturbing to observe, which art forms become part of, shall we say, a classroom. And I'm using classroom as an idea, not as a box with windows and doors. What becomes part of the classroom formalization of importance, and what remains informal, or the other word that is used, extracurricular, or, for example, something that is celebratory and that needs to be learned? Does the positioning of certain art forms in these categories say something about what we feel about those art forms, and by inference about the people who practice, celebrate, and live within the cultures that these art forms represent? This, I think, is an important question. Because every time I hear people speaking about art in schools, I naturally know what art form they're talking about. I instinctively know what they mean. What, even if it's not a specific art form, I know the sound of the music, and that troubles me. There needs to be music in school. Which sound are we talking about? Who has determined that framework or that sphere of sound? And why are we framing it that way? And I think that needs investigation, because embedded in this judgment that we place on what art is serious or what art needs to be learnt and what art needs to be, the other word, exposure, which is also problematic, we are actually practicing a form of discrimination that is embedded in caste and gender violence. And I think it's very important that the world of education takes note of this, because this happens very naturally and happens without us even realizing. So that, within quotes, folk art form is for exposure. It's for understanding a culture. But the song that I would sing has only certain sounds. Or even if it is taken from, within quotes, the folk, it is gen curated to sound like what every other sound sounds like in the accepted norm. These are all things that slip by because they live in the aesthetic, in the color, in the movement, in what, for example, what is vulgar, what is not vulgar, what is... So we are talking about children, we are making all these decisions on moral, ethical grounds, so we believe, but I don't think we investigate them enough. And I think fundamentally the problem behind this is we don't recognize art as knowledge. We are willing to recognize some arts as possibly knowledge. And there I still say possibly. But a lot that is art is not recognized as knowledge. The moment it is not seen as knowledge, the notion of learning itself changes. The idea of what is our interaction with that being changes. So it is important that we see art, all art forms, as bodies of knowledge and bodies from which we learn and from which we grow. And in that fashion, I think our soundscape, our colorscape, our notion of aesthetics, movement, everything then can really expand. Because if we speak, like Andalakshmi Akka spoke about, equality, there must be equality in sound. There must be equality in color. There must be equality in movement. And when there is equality in those manifestations of cultures, then there is the feeling of equality. And then there is the function of equity. Because if you don't see it in these emotive ways, they are just intellectual exercises we put into what we believe we represent. And they still don't pass on in the emotional values that we need to carry forward and learn as teachers and students. So, I've not even touched upon the other framework of, for example, how is art itself produced? While we celebrate art, while we celebrate color, even if we celebrate it in an egalitarian fashion, what about that which happens behind it? That's not a clean slate. That's a complex space. For example, when I wrote this book, The Sebastian and Sons, I have been singing music from the age of six. I have been a performer, whatever that means, from the age of 12. And I knew nothing about the people who made the mridanga. Nothing. So, what about the learning of that which happens behind? How much of that should be part of the idea of art being in a classroom? Or learning about cultures, if we can expand the scope of today's framework? How much of that should be part of our experience of the art? It messes our experience of the art. But can that also be part of a child's education, especially senior school? That when they walk out, they actually walk out wanting to learn, not having been given, shall we say, solutions or even confirmed paths of understanding. I know I have very little time, so I'm going to skip a few other ideas and move to another frame, which is the learning of art itself beyond the school education or college education framework. And like I pointed out to anomalies and issues that we need to think about in art within that classroom, the classroom where art is supposed to be central is also problematic. Here there are two, shall we say, models. One is a model where you have an academic setup. You have a pedagogy for learning painting, for learning music, for learning dance, etc. So you have an institutionalization. And then you have the way I learned music, what we called in Tamil, Pata class, where a teacher comes home or you have an informal school and there's a group of children learning music, dance, etc. Now, there are both these interactions. Let me first address one word before I go on. And I am going to problematize that word, and that's that word sadhana, or riyaz, as it is called. And in in the utterance of the word, many words have meanings in the sheer utterance of their, in their sonic sound. And one of the imageries that sadhana and riyaz gives us is this idea of this musician or this dancer locked up in this room where it is only the music and the dance and them, and shut out to the rest of the world. If that is sadhana, I don't want that. If that is practice, I don't want that practice. And I say that very carefully, knowing very well that immersion into an art form is essential. But the question is, what is that immersion? What are we immersing ourselves in? Is a question that we art students also need to ask. And I say this after many years of being actually locked in that room, or rather locking myself in that room. Yes, initially we need the skill sets, we need the tools, we need the ability to translate an idea into sound or movement or color, etc. But that's the technicalities of learning. And beyond that, when you need to really sing or listen, for that matter, that door has to be broken. The walls cannot exist. Which means, does the world of arts truly participate in the larger discourse of life? And here there needs to be a nuance. The nuance is art forms that belong to communities that are traditionally being pushed to the corner of society, to the margins of society, to the rim. They have to engage with the reality of life because they have no choice. Their life, their sorrow, their celebration are all part of the music because they're telling themselves and the world that this is our reality in all its shades, because nobody is willing to listen. And to get people's attention, you need to wear it on your sleeve. Whereas art forms like the one I practice don't need to wear that on their sleeve, because we have privilege in every quarter. And therefore, we can lock ourselves in that room. We can throw the key away and say we are in sadhana. It is really, really, really disturbing when I think of the words we use to associate with the art forms I practice, or the words that we use for art forms that don't fall into the, within quote, sadhana category. I sing divine music. Why is mine divine? And why is the parai sound of great parai artist not automatically considered divine? So sadhana itself should mean immersion in reality. And the sound of the music must be imbued with reality. And reality in its every sense, from the philosophical to the aesthetic, to the political, to the social, and much, much more. And therefore, the other institutionalization of art also has a certain formulae it has followed. Just look at the institutions we created for art forms. What are these art forms? They are primarily privileged art forms. Bharatanatyam got an institution. Kathakali got an institution. I can go on. Exceptions kept aside, we also decided which art forms needed that formal training, which don't, which can remain, like I said in the other case, outside the classroom. Therefore, when pedagogy is created, here too the pedagogy is created in a manner. There are other problems with pedagogy which I won't go into now, but pedagogy is also created in a manner that is exclusionary of the larger universe. That also needs to be thought about. So here we have art in two domains, more or less. And there are more domains. You have art in the world of special children. What does art do there? What about the agency of the special child? Is there an agency for the special child? Because as people who enable the conversation for special children in arts, it is seen as therapeutic. It is seen, of course, it is all that. But can we conceive of agency in that sense? So there are many more spheres that we can discuss the idea of art and education. What about the spirit that art itself gives us in that moment of its experience, which every one of us in this room have experienced? Can that spirit encompass our every interaction? Not that it will stay for long, but even if it does momentarily, can that be part of a learning? How can it be part of the learning? So there are many more spheres in which this idea of art and or in education can be discussed. But I'm going to leave it here, and I do hope I did raise at least some questions on art and education. I've been now asked to sing for a while. I don't know how long I spoke, but I will sing for a while, and I'd like to encompass in the musical rendition different traditions of music, including the Carnatic and possibly different languages. I won't call it a performance or a concert, it is just a sharing, which is for me far more precious than the formalized sphere of performing music, I guess. And therefore, I do hope you enjoy the music. Just give me a second. I'll start with a Carnatic composition of Shyama Shastri. It's in the raga Manji, Bruva Vamma. I'll begin with a Carnatic rendition and then move to other languages and other styles.
Virana Nive anath ranaje sita ambani ve anath ranaje sita anath ranaje sita amba nivahim pa vashama kamakshi brahvam amba devi tagal le Saho Dari Gamba Shama Krishna Saho Dari Shuka Shama Tripura Sun Saho Dari Shuka Shamale Tripura Sundari Gamba Imahilo Nisama Tamasya me
I'll now present a song written by my very dear friend, wonderful poet and author Perumal Murugan, who needs absolutely no introduction. We have been working together now, I think, for about 3-4 years, and he's written on various subjects, many coming from discussions we've had, some his own inspiration. And he wrote a set of songs on birds. And what makes this collection special is, I guess, much of what we notice and what we don't notice in every sphere, be it nature or society, is determined by what we value and what we don't value subconsciously, unconsciously. And there are certain birds we don't notice. And this collection has some of those birds. We keep talking about the parrot, the parakeet, the peacock, the nightingale. We rarely talk about the crow. We are very disturbed by the pigeon. I don't remember the last time I spoke of the quail. The list is never ending. And this is a song on the quail. And it's known as the kaadai in Tamil. So it's the kaadai paattu, or the quail song. The raga is khamas.
பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீரா இன்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீரா இன்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீரா இன்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீரா இன்பம்.
He's saying here, the joy in seeing the quail fly is never ending.
யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து யார்க்கும் தெரிய
மரத்தில் இருந்து ஈர்க்கும் நீல நிற ரக்கை சேர்க்க விரித்து செல்லும் போது பார்க்க யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து யார்க்கும் தெரிய மரத்தில் இருந்து இருக்கும் நீல நிற ரக்கை சேர்க்க விரித்து செல்லும் போது பார்க்க பார்க்க தீராயின்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீராயின்பம் கூர்நுனி ஓலை பனையில் குந்தும் கூர்நுனி ஓலை பனையில் குந்தும் பார்வையில் படும் பூச்சியை தேரும் கூர்முனி ஓலை பனையில் குந்தும் பார்வையில் படும் பூச்சியை தேரும் கூர்முனி ஓலை பனையில் குந்தும் பார்வையில் படும் பூச்சியை தேரும் போரம்பாய் படக்கென்று பாயும் போர் அம்பாய் படக்கென்று பாயும் பேர்தவானம் குணுக்கு போல போரம்பாய் படக்கென்று பாயும் பேர்தவானம் குணுக்கு போலே சீருடன் துள்ளி முருகியேறும் சீருடன் துள்ளி முருகியேறும் பார்க்க பார்க்க போரம்பாய் போரம்பாய் படக்கென்று பாயும் பேர்தவானம் குணுக்கு போலே சீருடன் துள்ளி முருகியேறும் பார்க்க பார்க்க தீராயின்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீராயின்பம் பனங்காடை பறக்கும் அழகை பார்க்க அழகை பார்க்க காடை அழகை பார்க்க பனங்காடை அழகை பார்க்க பார்க்க தீராயின்பம்
Next is a well-known song, Vaishnava Janato. I sing it in a kind of a transitional style, if I can use that term, tentatively. It starts in a Carnatic raga and then flows back into the well-known tune that all of you have heard.
Na re
वैष्णव जन तो वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे पर दुखे उपकार करे तो पर दुखे उपकार करे तो मन अभिमान नारायण रे पर दुखे उपकार करे तो मन अभिमान नारायण रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे सकल लोक मा सकल लोक मा सहुने वंदे निंदन करे केणी रे वाचकाच मन निश्चल राखे वाचकाच मन निश्चल राखे धन धन जननी तेणी रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे समदृष्टि ने तृष्णा त्यागी समदृष्टि ने तृष्णा त्यागी पर श्री जेणे मात रे जिह्वा थके असत्य न बोले पर धन नव झाड़े हाथ रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे मोह माया व्यापे नहीं जेने मोह माया व्यापे नहीं जेने दृढ़ वैराग्य जेना मन मारे मोह माया व्यापे नहीं जेने दृढ़ वैराग्य जेना मन मारे राम नाम शूताली लागे राम नाम शूताली लागे रहीम नाम शूताली लागे रहीम नाम शूताली लागे सकल तीरथ तेणा तन मारे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे वण लोभीन कपट रहित चे वण लोभीन
कपट रहित चे काम क्रोध निवार्यारे भणे नरसिंहो तेनो दर्शन करता भणे नरसिंहो तेनो दर्शन करता कुल एको तेरे तार्यारे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कही है जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे पर दुखे उपकार करे तो पर दुखे उपकार करे तो मन अभिमान नाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे सावरे आइजेयो 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 सावरे यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव मेरो गाँव यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव मेरो गाँव यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव यमुना किनारे मेरो गाँव सावरे आइजेयो सावरे आइजेयो सावरे आइजेयो सावरे यमुना किनारे मोरी ऊंची हवेली यमुना किनारे मेरी ऊंची हवेली यमुना किनारे मेरी ऊंची हवेली मैं ब्रज की गोपी का नवेली यमुना किनारे मोरी ऊंची हवेली मैं ब्रज की गोपी का नवेली मैं ब्रज की गोपी का नवेली राधा रंगीली मेरो नाम बंसी बजा के जइयो सांवरे आइ जइयो सांवरे आइ जइयो सांवरे राधा रंगीली मेरो नाम राधा रंगीली मेरो नाम बंसी बजा के जइयो सांवरे
आई जय ओ सावरे, 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 आई जय ओ सावरे। मल मल के स्नान कराऊं, मल मल के स्नान कराऊं, घिस घिस चंदन, घिस घिस चंदन, घिस घिस चंदन, भोर लगाऊं, पूजा करूं सुबह शाम, पूजा करूं सुबह शाम, मखन खा के जइयो सांवरे, आई जइयो सांवरे, आई जइयो सांवरे, आई जइयो सांवरे। खस खस रो महलो बनावहूं, खस खस रो महलो बनावहूं, खस खस रो महलो बनावहूं, चुन चुन कलियन, चुन चुन कलियन, चुन चुन कलियन, सेज बिछाऊं, चुन चुन कलियन, सेज बिछाऊं, धीरे 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 सांवरे, आई जइयो 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 सांवरे।
Next piece is something I've sung a lot, yet would like to sing it. I think it has resonance in our celebration today. It's the unsung parts of Janaganamana before it became a national anthem. As many of you would be aware, many other verses were not included in what is our national anthem today. I'd like to sing some of those verses.
Oh, raho tobo ahwano prochorito shunitobo udaro bani. Oh, raho tobo ahwano prochorito shunitobo udaro bani. Ahvano prochorito shunitobo udaro bani. Hindu Baudha Shikho Jaino Paro Shikho Musholo Manu Kristani. Hindu Baudha Shikho Jaino Paro Shikho Musholo Manu শিখো যেন পর শিখো মুসলো মান খ্রিস্তান পূর্ব পশ্চিম আসে তব সিংহাসন পাশে পূর্ব পশ্চিম আসে তব সিংহাসন পাশে প্রেম হরণত গাথা ঘোর তিমির ঘন নিবিড় নিশীতে পীড়িত মূর্ছিত দেশে গো তিমির ঘন নিবিড় নিশীতে পীড়িত মূর্ছিত দেশে জাগৃত ছিল তব অবিচল মঙ্গল নত নয়নে অনিমেষে এ জাগৃত ছিল তব অবিচল মঙ্গল নত নয়নে অনিমেষে দুঃস্বপ্নে আটঙ্কে রক্ষ করিল অঙ্কে স্নেহময়ী তুম মাতা রাত্রি প্রভাত দিল উদিল রবি ছবি পূর্ব উদয়গিরি ভালে রাত্রি প্রভাত দিল উদিল রবি ছবি পূর্ব উদয়গিরি ভালে গাহে বিহঙ্গম পুণ্য সমীরণ নবজীবন রোষঢালে গাহে বিহঙ্গম পুণ্য সমীরণ নবজীবন রোষঢালে তব করুণারুণ রাগে নিদ্রুত ভারত জাগে তব চরণে নত মাথা তব করুণারুণ রাগে নিদ্রুত ভারত জাগে তব চরণে নত মাথা তব চরণে নত
I'll end with one more piece. I'll come back to the south for this one. Aruna, can I sing one and finish?
You can sing more. I just intervened to say you can sing three or four. Because there's more time. Please do. Please sing more than one. That's a request from many people. Many people have asked for special songs, but I'm leaving it to you. But please do sing more.
I'll sing two songs.
Three.
Aruna is somebody I think nobody can refuse, right? So that's her kindest order, so I shall follow. Think I know one of the requests that would have come in, so I will sing it. So I'll come back, I'll sing this song again, something I've sung a lot, but I think there's magic in singing something again and again. And there is a newness which never goes away every time some things are sung or said or recited.
हम देखेंगे हम देखेंगे लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे हम देखेंगे हम देखेंगे लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे हम देखेंगे वो दिन के जिसका वादा है जो लोहे अजल में लिखा है हम देखेंगे लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे हम देखेंगे वो दिन के जिसका वादा है जो लोहे अज़ल में लिखा है हम देखेंगे लाजिम है कि हम भी देखेंगे हम देखेंगे अनीदिगळनेडु मलपन्नी पोले
I'm singing Hum Dekhenge in four languages.
Anidigal nedumalappanni pole thula malaiyettava veelum bolum Anidigal nedumalappanni pole thula malaiyettava veelum bolum அதிகாரம் என்னும் அலங்காரம் அல்ல ஜனங்கள் என்னும் எஜமானன்மார் உறப்பல்லே அநீதிகள் நெடுமலப்பன்னி போலே தூலாமழை ஏற்றவ வீழும் போலும் அதிகாரம் என்னும் அலங்காரம் அல்ல ஜனங்கள் என்னும் எஜமானன்மார் உறப்பல்லே நம்ம காணேண்டே ஹம் தேகேங்கே லாசிம் ஹேக் ஹம் பி தேகேங்கே லாசிம் ஹேக் ஹம் பி தேகேங்கே ஹம் தேகேங்கே கருணைய தேவரு ஆதாகா கருணைய தேவரு ஆதாகா ஆ தேவரு குடியச்சே நடேதாகா கருணைய தேவரு ஆதாகா ஆ தேவரு குடியச்சே நடேதாகா தள்ளிசிக்கொண்ட நமகெல்ல ஆதேவர சனிஹாசிக்காக தள்ளிசிக்கொண்ட நமகெல்ல ஆதேவர சனிஹாசிக்காக கத்திகளெல்லாம் உருளோதான் கத்திகளெல்லாம் உருளோத அதிகாரங்களும் நெகது பேளோத நொடோனே ஹம் தேகேங்கே லாசிம் ஹேக்கு ஹம் பி தேகேங்கே லாசிம் ஹேக்கு ஹம் பி தேகேங்கே ஹம் தேகேங்கே ஆண்டவன் பெயரே நிலைத்திருக்கும் ஆண்டவன் பெயரே நிலைத்திருக்கும் அது மறைந்திருக்கும் எங்கும் நிறைந்திருக்கும் ஆண்டவன் பெயரே நிலைத்திருக்கும் அது மறைந்திருக்கும் எங்கும் நிறைந்திருக்கும் காட்சியும் அதுவே காண்பதுவும் உள்ளொளியின் உண்மை முழக்கமாகும் உள்ளொளியின் உண்மை முழக்கமாகும் அதுவும் உள்ளே என் உள்ளே படைப்புயிர் எல்லாம் எழுந்து நிற்கும் அதில் நீயும் தான் நானும் தான் பார்ப்போமே ஹம் देखेंगे लाजिम है के हम भी देखेंगे लाजिम है के हम भी देखेंगे लाजिम है के हम भी देखेंगे हम देखेंगे वो दिन के जिसका वादा है जो लोहे अजल में लिखा है
Yeah.
There's a request from Anand's family.
Yes.
Apara Brahma.
I don't know the song. What song is this? I don't know this song, sorry. Apara Brahma, which one? Is it the first words they're telling me by any chance, or is it lyrics in between?
I'm reading out what they've written.
Unfortunately, I don't know that song. Apologies. I'll sing two pieces, the last two pieces, which I will sing together. First will be a prayer, followed by a composition of Sri Narayana Guru, the philosopher, the aesthete, and the social reformer from Kerala. Before that, I will sing a prayer and I'll conclude with that composition of his. Om Tat Sat. Om Tat Sat. Shri Narayana Tu. Om Tat Sat Shri Narayana Tu. Om Tat Sat Shri Narayana Tu. Purushottama Guru Tu. Purushottama Guru Tu. पुरुषोत्तम गुरु तु सिद्ध बुद्धि तु स्कंद विनायक सविता पावक तु ओम तत्सत ओम तत्सत श्रीनारायण तु पुरुषोत्तम गुरु तु सिद्धबुद्धि तु स्कंद विनायक स्कंद विनायक स्कंद विनायक 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 सविता पावक तु पावक तु ब्रह्म मज्द तु सविता पावक ब्रह्म मज्द सविता पावक सिद्ध बुद्धि तु
ब्रह्म मस्द तू यह शक्ति तू ब्रह्म मस्द तू यह शक्ति तू ईशु पिता प्रभु तू सविता पावक 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 तू ब्रह्म मस्त तू यह शक्ति तू ईशु पिता प्रभु तू ईशु पिता प्रभु तू रुद्र विष्णु तू राम कृष्ण तू रुद्र विष्णु तू राम कृष्ण तू रहीम 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 ताओ तू रहीम ताओ तू रहीम राम कृष्ण ईशु पिता ब्रह्म मस्द तू यह्व शक्ति तू स्कंद ईशु रहीम ताओ तू वसुदेव गौ विष्णु रूप तू अद्वितीय तू चिदानंद हरि तू अद्वितीय तू चिदानंद हरि तू हरि तू राम तू ईशु तू रहीम तू रहीम राम ईशु ब्रह्म मस्द तू तत्सत् ॐ तत्सत् समस्त प्रपंचं सृजिच्चुं भरिच्चुं मुदा संहरिच्चुं रसिच्चुं रमिच्चुं समस्त प्रपंचं सृजिच्चुं भरिच्चुं मुदा संहरिच्चुं रसिच्चुं रमिच्चुं समस्त प्रपंचं सृजिच्चुं भरिच्चुं मुदा संहरिच्चुं रसिच्चुं रमिच्चुं കളിച്ചും പുളച്ചും മഹാഘോരഘോരം വിളിച്ചും മമാനന്ദദേശേ വസിച്ചും സമസ്ത പ്രപഞ്ചം സൃജിച്ചും ഭരിച്ചും മുദാ സംഹരിച്ചും രസിച്ചും രമിച്ചും കളിച്ചും പുളച്ചും മഹാഘോരഘോരം വിളിച്ചും മാമാനന്ദദേശേ വസിച്ചും തെളിഞ്ഞും മറഞ്ഞും തുളുമ്പും പ്രപഞ്ചം തെളിഞ്ഞും മറഞ്ഞും തുളുമ്പും പ്രപഞ്ചം തുളഞ്ഞുള്ളിലോളമുള്ളായിരുന്നു തെളിഞ്ഞും മറഞ്ഞും തുളുമ്പും പ്രപഞ്ചം തുളഞ്ഞുള്ളിലെല്ലോളമുള്ളായിരുന്നു തിരിഞ്ഞും പിരിഞ്ഞും മഹാനന്ദധാരാം ചൊരിഞ്ഞും പദാംഭോജ ഭക്തർക്ക് നിത്യം വരുന്നോര് തുമ്പങ്ങളെല്ലാം മറിഞ്ഞും തെളിഞ്ഞും മറഞ്ഞും തുളുമ്പും പ്രപഞ്ചം തുളഞ്ഞുള്ളിലോളമുള്ളായിരുന്നു തിരിഞ്ഞും പിരിഞ്ഞും
महानंदधारां चोरिन्युं पदांभोज भक्तर्क नित्यं वरुन्नोर तुम्बंगलेल्लाम കരീനീടുമാരാവിരാദംഗബീജം കുറന്നോരുനേരം നിനക്കുള്ള ഭക്തർ കരിഞ്ഞീലമട്ടുള്ള കൈവല്യരൂപം കരിഞ്ഞീടുമാരാവിരാദംഗബീജം കുറന്നോരുനേരം നിനക്കുള്ള ഭക്തർ കരിഞ്ഞീലമട്ടുള്ള കൈവല്യരൂപം സമസ്ത പ്രപഞ്ചം ശ്രജിച്ചും ഭരിച്ചും മുദാ സംഹരിച്ചും രസിച്ചും രമിച്ചും കളിച്ചും പുളച്ചും ശ്രജിച്ചും ഭരിച്ചും വിളിച്ചും സമസ്ത പ്രപഞ്ചം ശ്രജിച്ചും ഭരിച്ചും മുദാ സംഹരിച്ചും രസിച്ചും രമിച്ചും കളിച്ചും പുളച്ചും മഹാഘോരഘോരം വിളിച്ചും മമാനന്ദദേശേ വസിച്ചും വിളിച്ചും മമാനന്ദദേശേ വസിച്ചും വിളിച്ചും മമാനന്ദദേശേ വസിച്ചും
താങ്ക് യു.
So very difficult to come in to thank everyone on behalf of the School for Democracy for something that is beyond words, for an evening that's beyond words, for an effort that has, I mean, I think Anand, Dr. Anand Lakshmi was someone who lifted education to an art form, and today the School for Democracy, the family, have Krishna to thank, TM Krishna to thank for first, of course, talking about art as a form of education, but then really taking art to a way. I'm sitting here in the School for Democracy with 50 young people from rural Rajasthan, and there was no way they would have been able to feel either what Dr. Anand Lakshmi meant or what you have just done for all of us today, which is carry the feeling of what we are and what inclusion can be and what art can do to communicate that. So really, thank you from the bottom of our heart. There are so many fabulous comments that have come. So on behalf of all of them who have been thanking you, Krishna, please do read those comments. But today is actually a day to thank, of course, Dr. Anand Lakshmi, who touched so many of us and who continues, Anand continues to spread her Anandness all over. And the fact that she's brought us together, Suma Balagopal, who did such a fabulous job of bringing pictures and words in such a powerful script, describing Anand's life, and in that Sabha, to thank Sabha for her assistance in everything of putting all this together. Aruna, of course, because Aruna gave us many more songs. Krishna, you're right. I think the rest of us couldn't have done what she managed to do, and everyone's busy thanking her for getting you to sing some more. And of course, Dr. Anand Lakshmi's friends from Lady Irwin College, I'm part of a group, and it's amazing how much they look forward today, and I'm sure how much they will talk about this WhatsApp group, which is about Anand in a sense. And Krishna, I think what you did is in our times today, you gave us a feeling of how with compassion, gentleness, and yet a firm commitment to all the inclusive values through song and through words, whether or not one understood the particular words, one understood that you can be transported into something far better than what we are seeing around us. And this is one of the means of taking culture rather than the way culture is being misused. So thank you so much from all of us and from the School for Democracy. And I'm sure I'm inadequate in my thanks. So Aruna, if there's anything else you'd want to add, I do want to thank everyone in the School for Democracy also, because I'm part of it, but I can afford to tell them for all the effort that they have made to reach the word out and to manage this and to make sure. I think last year we had a taste of this with Madhavi Mudgal and Leela Samson, and it gives us an idea of paying tributes to people like Anand through art, through people who are committed to humanity and who use art and culture and music and dance. It teaches us a lot. So thank you to the School for Democracy.
Thanks to everybody, and thanks to Anand's family for giving us Anand. That is a great contribution to all our lives. They continue to give us joy. I would like to specially thank Hindu Bobby and all the nephews and nieces and Bhavani for being still a great support to all that we do. Thank you very much. Thank you, Krishna.
Thank you.